Speaking of this lady, Basma Alawee has been with us before, and has been with us for a while, because I'm looking forward to what she has to say. Basma is a wife, a mother, a humanitarian, a Muslim, an engineer, a teacher, a writer, and an activist, who arrived in the United States as a refugee from Iraq. Upon arriving in New York, she realized she came with significant advantages: a college education and fluency in English. It became her passion to help others like her succeed. She has volunteered with me in social services and world relief to help translate and help address new refugees to this country. She has helped pay online classes for Arabic speakers to get their GED, and she worked as the secretary of the local Iraq family organization. She is now director of the We Are All America campaign in Florida, advocating for refugee rights. And as a result of all her hard work, she was selected as the Florida delegate for the United Nations Human Rights Council Refugee Congress, which is a great achievement for her. Thank you for all the work you do, and we look forward to meeting you. Thank you.
Since last week, the Islamic world has been celebrating Ramadan. Ramadan is the 9 month of the Islamic calendar. It is the Islamic month of fasting, in which participating Muslims refrain from eating, drinking, from dawn until sunset. Ramadan has been the name of the 9 month in the Arabic culture, long before the arrival of Islam. In the Quran, it is said that fasting has been written down as obligatory upon you, as it was upon those before you, which is the reference to the Jewish practice of fasting beyond the law. Fasting is meant to teach the Muslim patient modesty is punctuality. I don't know what patient the male today. Ramadan is a time for Muslims to fast for the sake of God and to offer more prayers than usual. During Ramadan, Muslims ask forgiveness for past sins, pray for guidance, and help in affirming refraining from everyday evils, and try to purify themselves through self-restraining and good deeds. As compared to the solar calendar, the dates of Ramadan vary, moving backwards about 10 days each year, as it is moving holiday depending on the moon. Ramadan was the month in which the first verses of the Quran were said to be revealed to the Islamic prophet Muhammad. That was during the night that Muslim calls Laylat al-Qadr, the night of the Year of Measures. The night is believed to be one of the 10 last days of the month. Ramadan ends with Eid al-Fitr on the first of Shawwal, with much celebrating and fasting. And I choose this speaking of about Ramadan by Mary Abraham and the poetry called Holy Ramadan. Ramadan is a holy month. It's the month of mercy, worship, and blessing. Your heart becomes pure and empty from any depression. The month which the Holy Quran turned in, it's a unique month that has no twin. In this month, there is something actual, which is forming accurately every ritual. This month, embroiled in eyes of power, Laylat al-Qadr. It's a sacred night, and it's only 24 hours. It's a great night which all your prayers are accepted, and the mercy is everywhere, so no one can interpret it. A night which is superior to 1,000 nights, and no one can deny it. this because it's potentially right. This is a huge opportunity from God, and I think all the people agree on that. And I'm sorry if I am being myself because I'm fasting. Enough drinking and talk in the morning, it just makes me a better person. So today I have got a tremendous opportunity to express my feeling towards my mother and all the mothers of the world through these not so great words of mine. Sure, no words can describe our gratitude or thanks for our mothers. She is the most precious gift to us from Almighty. And I'm asking every mother in the room, can by saying mother, you don't need to really give a birth to a child. It can be an older sister, which is, I have two younger sisters than me, and I became mom when I was 8 years old. Okay? I was raising my sisters with my mom. So just by having a younger sister, you are a mother. Just by having a nephew or a niece, you are a mother. Just by having, I don't know, sometimes a teacher is a mother for many kids. So this is something I learned from someone, that if no one appreciates you, please appreciate yourself. And give yourself a big hug. And I'm sure you know, it's making you feel great. So, while you're sitting or standing, all the mothers, I want you to hug yourself really tight. Take a moment. You feel it, right? As God didn't have been present everywhere in the world, He must have created mothers to make up this mess. Everywhere in our life, mother's role is queen. Behind the success of every great person, there is in the inspiration of his mother. She is our first teacher, our first guide, and our first friend. She gives second taste of life when the child is born. She smiles when the child smiles. She cries when the child weeps, and she sleeps when she finds her child asleep. Her great source of happiness is the happiness of her child. She is content if her child is so, for the whole world is her children and family. She does everything to please each and every member of the family, yes, we do. In lieu of that, she doesn't want anything. We also take her and all the effort for us for granted, which is sad. In a way, she does a thankless job for us. No wages, no holidays, non-stop work, 365 days a year. She is the only creature of the world before whom even the God bows. She is the optimal of love, affection, sacrifice, and generosity. Her presence in the world provides solace to the suffering humanity. Her smiling face removes all sorrow and threats of the world. Mothers are a constant source of strength for fathers as well. Fathers teach them to form opinions and making all important decisions of life. Without mothers, fathers are incomplete. Sorry, fathers. So in a way, she is the necklace of the family. No mother, no family. No family, no society. And no society, no country. No world has and no existence of human beings. I can't say more beyond that. Thanks for listening with such a great passion. But my word is not done. I say happy Mother's Day. But through our day, let's not forget that we're teaching our mothers too. We are now witnessing the highest level of displacement on record. Around 68.5 million people around the world have been forced from home. Among them are nearly 25.4 million of refugees, over half of whom are under the age of 18. There are also an estimate 10 million stateless people who have been denied nationality and access to basic rights such as education, health care, employment, and freedom of movement. in a world where nearly one person is forced to displace every 2 seconds as a result of conflict or persecution, our voice and advocacy work today is more important than ever before. And now, I want to share with you, I have to do this every single day. So, questions and habits. I'm sure all of those here do. But I'm sharing with you today what a refugee mind to do list has, especially in a refugee camp. This list represents the experiences of several refugees and internally displaced people in a refugee camp. For most mothers, daily life revolves around the item on each day's to-do list: cook, check the kids, head to work, clean, help with homework, get kids to bed. In some ways, daily life for refugee moms is similar. They do many of the same things for their own families, but getting those things done looks entirely different for a mom whose family has been forced from their home by war. So the first one, we all get showers and get our kids ready in the day for the day. One of the refugees shared, she said, our home doesn't have a bathroom, so I pack my things and go outside to wait for the shower. In Jordan and Iraq, as many as 50 people share one bathroom. How many people do you share a toilet with in home? It's not feasible to shower every day, and we often wear the same clothes we slept in. There's not much privacy. It makes me nervous, both for myself and my 11-year-old daughter, which is how 11-year-old daughter is. Number two, drop my son off at school. In our tent settlement, there's an early education center. It's run by one of the aid groups working here, and helps kids get ready for school. But they are not ready to transition into the Lebanese school system they get left behind. Frankly, we are lucky to have it. Not every camp or settlement has access to place like this. But my son Omar just stands in the door watching other children play. He's so hesitant. Sometimes he takes a few steps in, and I can tell that he wasn't to stay. But he can't quite do it. And the second lady said, I know I am protected. I don't always know how much to let him move around the camp at his home. I want to keep him safe. And this place is so different from the structure and security of our home and community in Syria. Third, take the kids to work. We don't have an education center. If we did, we couldn't afford to use it. If we don't work all of us, we can't pay rent on the land we use. So we make and stack bricks for 8 cents a brick. My 12-year-old Juma misses school so much. He says that he's forgetting what he learned. My 4-year-old Sam should be playing. Not shoveling brick dust. We pulled out an old toy fire truck and he didn't know what to do with it. He's forgetting how to play. Do the laundry. We don't have a washer or dryer, so laundry has a lot of steps to it. Build a fire, get water from the tent, and boil it. Soak and scrub the clothes and hang them to dry outside. The sun's out, so the clothes should dry in a day. They get dusty and smell like smoke, but that's still better than having to hang them inside when it's raining or showering. They are in the wake of days and never really get dry. I take my son to the doctor. First, I need to check the bus schedule. We have to take 2 buses to get there. Sometimes I don't have bus fare, so I have to walk and carry him. Jamal likes to go to the doctor. It's good for his injured foot, and they are kind to him, but it's hard to afford the treatment. clean up and help with homework. Fold and pile sleeping mats and blankets from last night. Our family of seven shares one tent. So the one room we have has to work. We leave shoes at the door, but the floor is dusty when it's dry, and so muddy when it's raining. I feel like I'm always cleaning. If the kids have any homework, it has to be done early in the afternoon. Once the sun goes down, our life inside is really minimal. I work hard to keep the tent clean and make it a better place to live. I found flower sacks in the garbage and sewed them together to make walls for our tent. And I found some fabric to make the inside look better. Call my husband in Syria. My husband is the oldest son, so he stayed to Syria to care for his family. The place is under regime, he said. There are raids, bombs. We are constantly afraid of his life. He can't come from Syria, so sometimes I call him. Always praying that he answers the phone. Kids need a father. They need to feel protected and provided for. To feel like their family is complete and missing. And I really wish they were here with us. Fortunately, my kids don't have to work, but we don't have access to a children's center, and I'm scared to let them stay straight to work. I think they ask, what can we do, Mom, about a million times each day? They are bored all of the time. I think kids just kind of run wild around Solomon. I don't want my kids doing that. They are always fighting with each other, and I'm tired. This goes on and on. I wish it was only the only one that I can love, which is cooking dinner. Tell the kids for the 1,000,000th time, yes, we are having potatoes for dinner again. It's the one thing we can afford that will actually feed all of us. It's an afternoon event to get everything peeled, cut up, and cooked. I cook over an open fire. In some places, people can't at least access a shared single burner. Either way, it's a lot like camping. Believe me, camping stops being fun after you have been doing it for months or years. It's heavy, I know, but it's a reality. There are millions of people waiting outside our house, outside our door, outside our workers, and they need help. So I spent the last 2 weeks back and forth to DC to advocate for refugees with over 200 other refugee leaders. And we want Congress to protect the refugee resettlement program. And we asked them, and this is something I asked you, if you could help from your space, by making a phone call, by visiting an elected official. We asked them to hold the administration accountable to meeting the 30,000 refugees admissional goal for the fiscal year of 2019, and to setting the 2020 goal of at least bringing 75,000 refugees. The administration has reduced refugee resettlement from the historic average of 95,000 admission goal to just 30,000, and they aren't even meeting that goal. Our communities are ready and willing to welcome more refugees. Talk about supported volunteers, employers, and community groups. Member of Congress can write letters, request briefings, and ask questions for referral. We also ask our elected officials to sign the GRACE Act, which is, if you want to know more information about, I can send you. But the GRACE Act would set a minimum refugee admission goal of 95,000 each year, which is the average goal set between 1918 and 2017. It's all so, mandate quarterly reports on refugee admission increasing accountability. And we want them also to sign the No Ban Act, which repealed the Muslim ban, refugee ban, and asylum ban, and prevent the administration from setting such bans in the future. We are asking our House members to join the bipartisan congressional refugee caucus, which we have one of our House representatives for already done. His name is Dallas Ballard, and he is in South Florida, so we want to thank him for being in that caucus. And last but not least, we have things to do in Jacksonville. We have a group called RTD, which is there with me today. Their mission to empower refugee women through art, collaboration, sharing of resources for successful integration. And their vision is to share their story, culture, tradition, and language through art with the rest of the world. They meet monthly to share food, discuss common topics, share resources, and work with the refugee community. And their goal to help a three-dimensional exhibit, which is come to Jacksonville in August, to show the journey of refugees who are in Jacksonville. Please help them. They're going to be downstairs after the service, and help them with what they need. If you can connect with them and support them, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.